the prophet Isaiah was either a fool, a detached idealist with no connection to the real world, or he was the only realist whose vision was spot on. Isaiah's ministry stretched for a period of over 40 years, and we are told that he was married and had two sons. Most of what we know about Isaiah, we know from the inference of the book of Isaiah. He evidently moved easily among kings and the ruling class. He stated in the beginning of his book that he saw visions during the days of the four kings of Judah. It's also possible that Isaiah was a priest, especially when we note his dramatic call, which came in the temple right where a priest would have stood. But on the other hand, Isaiah was very comfortable talking about rural life and vineyards, so he must have spent some time away from the city. The world in which Isaiah lived was a chaotic, unjust, warring world. Israel was a storm-tossed nation threatened by the powerful Assyrians to the north and the east, and menaced by the Egyptians to the south and to the west. The king and his advisors were preoccupied with what they needed to do to present themselves, and fear was rampant. So it's from this context that we hear the words of either a detached idealist or a grounded realist. Over 2,700 years later, not much has changed. From the riots in Ferguson to a military presence in 130 nations, with over 1,000 military bases around the world, we too hear the same words in similar context and often embrace them as Pollyanna. But did you notice how the prophecy started? Do you remember what we shared just a few moments ago in the beginning of the second chapter? It began by saying this: in days to come. In days to come. Now that's the New Revised Standard Version. But the literal Hebrew is a bit more nuanced. In the literal Hebrew, the nuance goes towards saying in the back of the days, or better yet, in the midst of the present. Little different slant. In the midst of the present, Isaiah is suggesting that the present moment is ripe, or to use an Advent term, the present is pregnant with God's presence. The prophet's vision is becoming real now among us, for you and me, not merely at the end of time. Isaiah is pointing to a vision that is unfolding here and now that moves towards the future. And Isaiah points to how it will unfold and our part in it. Let's take a moment and analyze this vision. And it starts with our understanding of the supremacy of God. It begins with our faith in the sovereignty of God, from which everything else follows. Because only when both believers and religions acknowledge that God is who God said God is, and stop playing lip service with that, will the world ever change. J.B. Phillips says it best, especially during this time of Advent, and I coined his phrase when he said, "We live in a God-invaded planet." I like that. We live in a God-invaded planet, and that is the message of Advent. This sovereign creator of all things comes to be among us. The supreme has become the lowest in the form of a baby. Now, in the midst of this understanding, something happens. In the midst of that understanding, we are moved. We are inspired to respond. Isaiah continues with what we just read by saying this: all the nations shall stream to it. To what? Toward the mountain. This supreme essence. What on the surface once seemed distant, unreachable, and trite, now is coming into focus. The people stream to the house of God for a reason. There's a reason here. He goes on to say that he may teach us his ways, that we might walk in his paths. You see, we stream to God because we are eager to learn new ways. This is where faith is met with the willingness to change, repent, stretch, grow, and transform from our human sin to God's will. Isaiah then says, once we understand the supremacy of God, once we move towards God's will, then we are given a new spirit to deal with our relationships. Anybody need a dose of that after Thanksgiving? We are given a new spirit so that we might better relate to one another. How does that happen? It happens because we trust that God will instruct and guide our disputes. The Spirit will direct misunderstandings, and righteousness will prevail over wickedness. Our mistrust in each other will be overcome by our trust in God. It happens when we trust in the ultimate judge who will dispel our suspicions, our hatreds, and our fear of one another. You know, whether it's a marriage, our families, our friends, our church, our community, our nation, our world, it is always fear that destroys relationships. It is always fear. This fear manifests itself in any number of ways, but only when divine assurance overcomes our human anxieties can the Spirit move us beyond that. The promise that Isaiah points to unfolds. When we proclaim the sovereign God that moves us to live in His will and puts a new spirit in us, the promise of something marvelous happens. The tools of destruction manifested in our fears become agents of construction. Destruction becomes construction, where our ingenuity, our money, our expertise, our focus give life and no longer death. Where we earnestly strive for wholeness rather than always wallowing in our brokenness. Something changes when our faith in God is met by an eager response to walk in God's paths. You know, when I was growing up, I heard my parents say, heard my parents yell, mostly in my direction, "Mark, for the love of God, fill in the blank." On the other side of that, it's not a bad motto, not a bad slogan, not a bad proverb, not a bad direction to live. "For the love of God." You see, the very word of God speaks through Isaiah so that we might embrace a new way of being. A new spirit allows us to better think, speak, and act as prophets of peace. You see, you thought you were just coming to church today. You leave as a prophet of peace. We all are prophets of peace. The very word of God speaks through us so that we might embrace a new way of being. The season of Advent, and most specifically, the candle of peace, creates a light to overcome our darkness wherever it might linger. So I end this. What do we have here this morning? In the second chapter of Isaiah, what do we have? Do we have a loony, head in the clouds prophet so disconnected we scoff? Or is there something else happening here? I end with this quote from the Interpreter's Bible. That's heavy reading, the Interpreter's Bible. I usually don't get many quotes from the Interpreter's Bible, but I'm laying one on you now. Quote, "It is not the high idealism, but the everlasting sanity of the prophet that should strike our very hearts." My Advent hope, with the candle of peace lit before us, as that our hearts will be filled with the everlasting sanity of the prophet, and that we will leave this time as brothers and sisters and prophets of peace. Let us pray. Wonderful God, we thank you for Isaiah's vision. Not a far-off Pollyanna vision, but one that is placed in our hearts this morning. One that is placed in the middle of our darkness. May we be light. May we be your light as your prophets of peace. In your name we pray now and forever. Amen.